You're watching PEGRI TV, Rhode Island's public access channel.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. You've seen that seeing is believing. Your ears and your eyes will be bleeding. Please check to see if you're still breathing. Hold tight, because the show is not over.
Welcome, everybody, to Off the Ropes, your official wrestling talk show from the Official Wrestling Museum. We are your hosts. I am Angel, and I'm joined by the Official Wrestling Museum's Hall of Famer,
Mo Live.
And we are here this week talking about SummerSlam, everything that happened on that great show, giving our thoughts, our opinions, running it down just for you. Make sure you scan the QR code that's on the screen to help us make a National Pro Wrestling Day. It takes only 10 seconds to do, and it's totally free. And if we're talking about national days to honor people, let's talk about the three people that we have put into the Official Wrestling Museum's Hall of Fame the night of SummerSlam. From WCW, Sonny Ono.
Yeah, Sonny Ono.
Which, like you said in the other times, the Selfie Master was seen with Ultimo Dragon, perfect pairing to a T.
Yuji Nagata. Yeah, Ultimo Dragon, Yuji Nagata, Psychosis for a while.
Yeah.
basically any Japanese person that came in, he managed.
Yeah.
Just like Mr. Fuji. And then also ECW fame, John Rechner, who everyone would know as Balls Mahoney.
Yeah.
Threw one of the meanest chair shots in the business, especially when he got into the era when he started zip tying the chairs. I mean, this guy, I don't know how many concussions this guy caused.
He was in Primal Conflict a couple of times.
Yeah, we worked with him. Great, you know.
Awesome.
Striker
guy.
Was really, they had a little bit of a little connection.
Yeah. And then Gangrel was also inducted into our Hall of Fame, which to me, phenomenal gimmick.
What a memorable gimmick. Theme song, one of the, if we're doing, like, I'm sure, you know, probably around March, we'll do like a March Madness theme song tournament or something.
Yep.
That's gonna be in there. That's gonna be making the
Absolutely.
List, you know. That Guaranteed. Entrance was so great. I mean, even more so than him, his in ring work, I think his character and sometimes that's just how it works out. Your character is so memorable and really so memorable at a time when you would probably be like, when reality was kind of kicking in and you're like a vampire, but it was awesome.
It really definitely was. So congratulations to you three. And just keep giving us a follow on our social medias and checking our YouTube pages and our websites to see who's the next individuals that are going to go into our Hall of Fame. You never know when we're going to be able to induct somebody. So let's jump right into SummerSlam.
Yeah, so right off the bat, I mean, we talked a little bit during it, and we were talking about grades. For me, up until halfway through the show, it was like a B. Get to the end, it was like an A. A plus, it was in that range. I'll go with an A because A plus means you can't get any better.
Yeah,
I'll say it was like A minus to an A, definitely.
I'm definitely going to agree with you with that. I personally only seen a couple of faults to the show. Why don't we get our faults out other way? For me, one fault was the arena was so dark.
And there were times where it was.
They already
dark.
They had about 10,000 seats blocked off for the show, so I get why they made it dark. But I remember watching it, and we were only a few matches in when it was starting to get dark in the building, well, in the arena. And I'm like, "Wow, this isn't a building. Oh no, wait, this is a stadium."
No.
And it kind of gave the vibe of being in a stadium, not there.
I heard a few people talk about how the crowd seemed low energy, and I don't think...
That's another thing.
But I don't think it was that. I think it seems to always be this way for these big arena shows that you... I remember feeling that way for Royal Rumble, and it wasn't, though. It was more so, it's these big arena shows, and the sound is so different. And especially an outdoor arena, you know, the sound goes up. It doesn't bounce off the roof and come back. So right. It just goes up. So you don't get that across TV. It doesn't seem as loud.
But... you know, this is a multi-million dollar company, right? That's owned by a multi-billion dollar company. You would think they would know.
Well, what are they going to do? Build an egg?
You have all these concerts that get shown on TV with an open stadium, and you can hear those crowds perfectly. You know, put some microphones. The crowd completely died when Logan Paul came through the curtain, which to me was.
I think MGK had a little piece of that murder. You know,
yeah,
once you
see
MGK, you're like,
Yeah, I think so too. But the crowd just died and could not come back. And I think another fault that they really had on the show was they did not utilize Miz at all. I think
they never do with the host. You know, they never do.
Where you have a show now that's over 2 hours of dead time in between every match.
Yeah.
Okay. And you have a host like Miz that now had R-Truth tagging along with them. Why not, even if it wasn't for TV purposes, why not have them out in the crowd?
Well, maybe, I don't know.
They could have did a skit where...
We'd probably have to ask Stryker because he was there on assignment.
Yep.
But why not ask him, hey, maybe they did use Miz during those commercial breaks.
It could be.
I mean, I wasn't there, so.
I haven't seen any reports on it.
Right.
And I haven't got to talk to Stryker prior to us, filming this episode. But to me, it was like they easily could have had Miz in the crowd at one time and Truth over. What are you doing way over there? We were supposed to, and it would have got the crowd back into it.
I will say the one time they did come out, I wasn't finding them funny until R-Truth said, oh, it's Robert Gibson. He just had his eye fixed.
Yeah.
But another fault for me, there weren't many. I think I mentioned it in the hot tag. I think that too many people ran their shoulders into the pole, and the first match was all about shoulder work, and the second match, right off the bat, they were working on the shoulder. They stepped out of it, so it turned out okay. But a thing for me that wasn't a problem until the end is with Roman coming out, and you know he's gonna hit the spear. Why did you have Bron Breakker use his spear to beat Sami Zayn? He could have done the choke into the military press power slam. The reason I say that, and a million people are going to go, because it's Bron Breakker's finishing move too. I know that. But Bron Breakker's spear and Roman Reigns' spear are completely different.
Absolutely.
Bron Breakker looks like he's running through you. Compare Bron Breakker and Roman Reigns' spear. Roman Reigns' spear looks like an 8-year-old's doing it. Bron Breakker's spear
Absolutely.
Is like...
And
it destroys Roman's spear.
And you're trained in this business to protect the next generations and the matches that are coming. And to me, like you said, I think the ending kind of, the way Orton came out, well, we'll talk about that when we get into that and stuff. And we tend to run and not have enough time, so
we
are going to try to get through things as much as possible.
What we can do real quick is bang out the Braun-Sammy match. Because it wasn't a bad match. But it was short. It never reached that next gear for me.
Yeah, but I don't think it was supposed to. I think that was supposed to be the match that was the break.
Know
what I mean?
It was Braun's make.
It was supposed to make him something. I don't think it was supposed. I think it was probably a time to sell. And I don't want to say it was the popcorn match of the show, but to sell the popcorn, to sell the souvenirs, to get to the bathrooms. They knew they could focus on. You have the legends in the crowd, so they had enough they could focus on. Filming with that, his father was there, his uncle was there, and let's face it, if Breakker didn't go over in this would have killed Breakker. He needed to go over.
And
I don't think Breakker needs a title.
They've done it at SummerSlam a couple of times. They've done some squash matches.
Yeah.
Not that this was a squash, but just Braun came in and totally, I mean, it just was like, wow, it's already over. When he hit that spear, I'm like, already?
Yep.
Nice clean win for him though, something that he needed, like you said. I just was surprised at how short it was, but it's good that he got that win like that too. It's like, okay, he didn't have to, you know what I mean? Sammy, everyone's so used to Sammy making the comebacks, and this time he just got dominated.
Now, what about Bayley and Nia Jax?
Now, I've heard some people not liking it. I thought, I pretty much knew that once Bayley won the title at Mania, she was losing it to Nia. I just felt that way.
Yep.
I didn't mind it. A lot of people, I've seen a lot of confusion with Tiffy come to cash in. And a lot of people I've read say, why would she come cash in when Nia was on offense? I don't think they're getting that she wasn't coming to cash in at all.
No, she wasn't.
She was just making a distraction.
Right.
Because they said as soon as she did it, Bayley powerbombed Nia powerbombed Bayley. Yeah, exactly. She caused a distraction. So right. I think I knew that was going to happen. Right. So I think it was a good match, though, and I really liked. Not to cut you off, I'll just finish my last point. I really liked that Nia, even though earlier she hit her with one, she had two bonsai drops.
Yep, they really protected Bayley at the end of the match on giving it to Nia by making her have to hit the two bonsai drops to keep her down. I think it was very well done. I don't think they killed Bayley at all through this, and I think they were able to keep a story going. Not a bad match at all.
Let's set up. Because these are the matches that you could probably get through quick. Because they were there. But
we're not trying to say we want to get through them quick.
Right, because those main events were.
Our show is only a half hour. Right. And by the time we get to the stuff that we've like, oh, yeah, we can hit on this, we have to go through it quick.
So. I did like LA Knight and Logan Paul. It was, decent for what it was. I did get really scared when LA Knight went to superplex Logan Paul off the top.
I did too.
It almost looked like it almost turned into a fisherman buster.
Yeah.
I'm tired of the brass knuckle thing because he's got the loaded hand already. I don't understand.
Yeah, I never understood the brass knuckles with him because of the loaded hand.
MGK almost ruined everything because he kept in the crowd. You could see him already trying to do things. LA Knight winning that belt. I think he'll be able to go on now and do some cool things maybe with Carmelo. And it was a good match, though. I'm not going to say – Logan Paul is incredible for what he does.
Yeah, in all honesty, a lot of people get on Logan Paul, but for what he's done, he keeps improving and getting better and better. To say he's a WWE superstar, he is.
Two guys on the roster.
Yeah, he's made it. He's just not a celebrity walking through the door anymore. He's good at what he does and how he delivers it. Match was great. The downfall of the match for me was the crowd just died out.
I think MGK,
with LA Knight, you would think that crowd just died. And I don't know what really it had. I don't know. It completely died the crowd. And I was like, wow, I'm so surprised. But LA Knight winning, I think, was a great thing. Got over really well.
Yeah.
But that superplex off the top, that was.
I get scared anytime a guy, Braun Breaker does it too, where he runs and just jumps onto the third. It's like, that's incredible. But I always get scared in case they fall back.
Yeah,
it happened to Braun a couple weeks ago with the Frankensteiner.
Those ropes get slippery.
Yeah.
Somebody just hits that corner on that jump. They're really sweaty. You know what I mean?
Let's hit up the opener before we get to the three.
Yeah, let's go to the opener.
I thought
phenomenal.
I thought coming out, you could see. I was like, this is the last time for Dom and
Rhea. I
don't know. You could just see it.
Yep.
I don't think that they purposely were letting off that vibe. No. I think you could just feel it. And it was time.
And you know what? For the credit of WWE, it could be because we've been in the business for 25 years that we might have picked up on that. That an average fan may not have picked up on stuff like that. So, let's toss that out there because I don't think they meant to do it. But, you can tell.
I thought it was a good match for what it was. I'm glad that Rhea didn't win because her coming back and winning doesn't make sense in the sense of she's already just going to dominate. Like, no, now she's still going to chase.
Yep.
And she did win, but she didn't. She hit her with the riptide and everything. The one thing I didn't like was the turn. Not that I didn't like the turn. I thought what didn't make sense to me was earlier in the match, Dominic pushed Rhea out of the way so Liv would dive and hit on the floor. That one part didn't make sense to me because why would he do that when he wants her to win? Why would he allow herself to get hurt,
I seen a couple things posted up online and it was saying when Rhea was smashing her face on the stairs is when you see Dom kind of react differently than smile. So
I'd have to go back and watch. The shoulder thing was a little bit bothersome too. And only in the way of, she's like, oh, it's out. Okay, and then she tries to pop it in. That's cool. Then Liv kicks her as hard as she can into it. And then it's like, okay, do all these beatings on her shoulder. Wouldn't that have popped back in? I get it. It's cool. When she was doing it on the shoulder, it wasn't as good as when she did it on the table. I think they relied on it too much.
It definitely should have been a focal
point because she's been out with
it. I think it was good. I honestly think how they booked it was very well done for an opening match, for what they had to do and tell the stories between those three to move it on to the next chapter.
Yeah.
Because all great stories need to continue.
I think the next chapter is
it's
a Hell in the
very
Cell.
Easy to keep now her as a face and for her to go.
I mean,
over.
Yeah, no one's
very,
gonna,
very well
Rhea's
done.
The biggest,
Liv pleaded
Rhea's
up.
Rhea's one
phenomenal.
Of the biggest faces in the company.
Yeah.
Now and, you have even more sympathy for her.
Right. And if Liv dropped the ball or dropped the title, Liv would have been done. There really wouldn't have been anything else.
The crescendo would have been there.
Yeah.
It still is going to go up now because the story is still going to be
Dom.
Told.
If Rhea won, what would you have done for Dom? Now there's so much more that can be told and to be put out there. I think this is great.
Yeah, Dom was getting boring as a character. Now this adds new life to him, you know.
And if we're talking about betrayal.
I was going to say, we might as well go right into the. Like,
exactly.
Speaking of the Judgment Day and where they're going to go. We talked during this match specifically because I am Gunther, man. I am a big Gunther fan, and I loved this match, the physicality in this match. Some people say he's boring. It's to each their own style. To me, that's my style. I love watching, and to me, it was Damian Priest's best in-ring showing that I think he's had. Not to say he's bad. I really like Damian Priest. I think this was his best in-ring showing. I think him and Gunther really clicked. I really liked the build-up in the sense of it added the heat between the two of them. And I guess just fast-forwarding to the ending, you saw when I was texting. When Finn came out, I said, dude, if he interferes, this match is ruined for me. Because my thinking is always the champion, not all the time, but a big title win should be done without help. Finn put the foot on the rope, and I was like, I was so mad. But I will say this, my way of thinking completely changed, and that's the way I think, but my way of thinking changed when Damian Priest saw it on the screen, turned around and saw it, and then Gunther had him in a choke. But Damian Priest got out of it, and then while he was out of it, lunged towards Finn Balor, trying to choke him. At that point, getting Finn Balor was more important than the title to him, and Damian Priest, to his credit, for me, made that believable.
He did.
And I really liked the match. I turned around and said, you know what? I've come around on the ending. Different than a distraction in another match, which we'll get to. But for me, that match really was great.
To me, I didn't know how that match was going to play out because you had two superstars that you needed to get over. It was already going into this show that you knew Damian Priest was going to be turning face at some point after this event, no matter if he had the belt or not. Right. You had Gunther by himself at this point. You needed to keep Gunther. What were you going to do? And the way they just was brutal right at the very beginning, Priest over on Gunther really showed the level of where Priest was and where he's at. I think it was great going back and forth. It was kind of odd seeing Finn out there and Priest okay with it right away. But at the same time, it was also a time that Priest was down for a little bit and beaten. So it was, all right, yeah. And he didn't have that time. I absolutely love the fact they used the replay.
Yeah, that's
for
what,
him to see it.
I think that's
made
what,
everything in that match. Because if he didn't, and he's like, wait, what? You
when he saw it, when
it
worked,
that was just picture perfect. Yeah. And I think it told the story and Gunther went over. Now, my only concern, now obviously, Judgment Day's up in the air. Obviously, Damian Priest is now face, so you have two faces out of the day. Great, you have storylines coming out of it. It's going to be phenomenal. But what does this leave for Gunther? Because Gunther, his people that he can work are kind of here, there, and everywhere.
I don't want to get into
it. And we can get into it another time.
Yeah, I have so much ideas.
And we kind of talked about this a little bit earlier.
We could do that next week.
Yeah. I think of all the world champions for this particular run of this title belt itself, this image belt, I think Gunther is set up to fail the most out of all the groups.
I disagree
because
completely.
Because I don't feel there are that level with the people. I don't know. I just it's going to be interesting to
my
see
disagreement
the booking.
Is because
and it's not against
it's the
him.
Easiest title run to run because all you have to do is just keep setting up opponents. He'll knock them down. But we'll do that next week because I have so many ideas.
Yeah.
We're doing pretty good on time for
this. We are doing good.
We got two more matches.
Two more matches.
Where do you want to go? You want to go title or do you want to go Punk and Drew?
We got to do Punk.
All right.
Now.
So when I talked about the distraction thing in that match that really worked for me, in this match, first off, Drew looks, when he comes to the ring, this guy looks so incredible. Like, he looks like, if you say a professional wrestler, that's who I want my professional wrestler to look
absolutely.
Like. I think that Seth did really good. He didn't overshadow or overtake the match, to my surprise. I loved when Punk was like, I don't care about your stupid Sabu pants.
Yeah.
But so when I was talking about, we'll get to the end. I thought it was a fair match. I heard people say it wasn't this great. It didn't have to be this great match because it wasn't going to be that.
But you know what?
It was
a
brawl.
I think it was a great match.
It was good.
It was great because it told the story.
And I think, so when I get to the distraction part that I thought was too much, when Punk had him in an anti-kind of vice and saw the bracelet and stopped to take it off, that, very believable. When he had Drew up for the GTS and then saw the bracelet on Seth's hand and then stopped and dropped him, I'm like, dude, you would have hit him with that and then gone over. That's what kind of took me out a little bit.
To me, if this was back in the day, I think, yes, he would have dropped him first, then went over to him. I think now it just shows that it was the disrespect that he thought was given. But in reality, he just put it on him instead of putting it in a pocket. And I think that was really well told. In all honesty, it is kind of odd that this was a fan that made it. You know what I mean? There's a Twitter account with the fan that actually made this bracelet.
I hope he got paid for that then.
No, it's a young girl.
I hope.
And she actually posted up and she asked, I think, Slim Jim, does she get any kickback because she's the one that made the bracelet and the whole match was built around that. I really hope so.
Yeah,
because
you get some...
To be honest with you, like, okay, yeah, it's cool. You know, it's something different.
Yeah.
But, like,
it added...
he just got it. It's not even like the and I'm nothing against the person that made the bracelet. The person wasn't sick, disabled, nothing like that. It was just a fan.
I don't know. I mean, I'm not going to knock
that.
It.
And I'm not saying it's stupid. But what about, like, if he found the marriage ring? He got the ring.
But you know what,
like,
man? I'm not going to... I mean, look at it. I mean, I wear this thing wherever I go.
Right, right.
If... You know what I mean?
You're absolutely right.
What if I was in a match and the guy had it? You know, I don't think the bracelet thing is like, oh, that stupid bracelet. I just think in the moment, he should have GTS'd him and then done it. But then again...
You got to remember, too, throughout the whole match, they're going back and forth, too.
Right.
So I think it was very well told on all three parts.
Yeah.
I think it's going to be easily to
There's more to come. There's more to come.
It was the only way they could have booked those three.
Yeah. All right, we have to, we're really zooming
we
in these.
I'm surprised.
I know, we'll get to this last one now.
Yeah.
Thankfully, as we've said, Triple H being in charge now, it seems like quality over quantity. We're getting four matches shows, and they're great matches, and they're great shows. And now we get to hit the last one. I thought Solo looked better. Again, like I said about Damian Priest, I thought this was his best in-ring work he's done. I didn't see him in NXT. But this was his best in-ring work, and I'm not even just saying because of Cody. I think Solo looked good. I really liked the story during the match of Solo knew everything Cody was going to do, the punch, the kick, every move Solo had an answer for.
Going into this match, Solo needed a very strong outing.
Yeah, he did.
He was booked since the time he beat John Cena as the weak link.
Even before then.
Yeah, he jobbed out on all house shows. Mm-hmm. Shows on TV, he was not built to be that next person.
Right.
It was like,
I didn't believe it.
We're going to do Roman Reigns till he's out, and then we'll just give it to him because he's the next big guy in the group.
Yeah.
And it just, to me, it just haven't, right, it just hasn't gone over in that particular way, especially with his gloves. Like, the gloves to me,
they don't fit.
Not only they don't fit,
they're weird to me.
They're Bray Wyatt gloves.
They do, they feel like Bray Wyatt gloves.
I wonder if eventually,
I don't know if it's a tribute to him. But
maybe
they do.
I'm not sure. It's just right. I think he needed a great.
So we know like the first 16 minutes was gonna be the match. I'm just saying because I know we get caught up on time.
He did what he needed to do to get himself over.
So then the real match starts once Cody gets him in the crossroads. Then you're like, okay, here we go.
Yep.
So then Bloodline comes out.
Here's what I don't like about that part. Can I tell you? I'm gonna tell you. That Kevin Owens' music hits. I hate. When a run out and the music hits. Even if they hit the music when they're halfway down the aisle, I would be okay with that. Who comes out, I'm going to save him, hit my music.
I'm coming
out. Not going to happen.
Yep.
Then Randy Orton. Now, this isn't like Kevin Owens and Randy Orton doesn't get along. They've been teaming together.
Right, right.
When did they come out together?
Right. And Randy Orton comes out and it takes him
hands.
Seven years to get down because he's going to do this
hands
stuff.
And he's asking right. the crowd, this way, thank you. You follow the yellow brick road. Going, there's only one yeah. way to go to.
Going back a little bit to the entrance. What did you think when you saw Arn Anderson? Because I was like, oh, man.
I thought that was awesome.
It was awesome.
I thought that was awesome.
Same, I think he was wearing the same shirt as you.
Probably.
I think it was before great. We get out of time, because we can go back a little bit.
Yeah.
Before we get out of time, when Roman's music hit, first off, it was a new theme they yeah. had added into it. But I didn't expect to see Roman tonight. We had talked a little bit about stuff.
I kind of think we're...
I thought, though, you know, with Jacob Fatu...
Yeah, we bounced back and forth yeah. with him if it's a real thing, if it's not a real thing.
With his injury?
Yeah, I kind of think yeah. that kind of derailed a little. At least that night, I felt like it derailed what was going to happen because Roman seemed to have taken a long time to get out there, a long time
well,
to is, get to the ring.
It is 100 yards to
and
ring.
And I get it, but like,
I think
if
so
somebody
theory,
disrespected so what, your family, yeah. stuff like that, I would think it would have been
Yeah. I mean,
boom.
What we're talking about is Jacob Fatu, after he hit the splash through the table, seemed like he hurt himself. I tend to think, and this is, we don't know yet, I tend to think that it was more of a work to keep him out of the ring so that Roman and Fatu, who definitely have a big future against each other, don't even touch at this show. You had so much going on. Do you really want Roman to come in, Superman punch Jacob Fatu one time, he drops out of the ring, and then he spears Solo? No. Keep him out. At the end, Solo was like, hey, you're dead, Roman, you're done. They didn't get to touch. So I think it saved... Not only saved Jacob Fatu, I think it saved that collision.
What I thought was going to happen with Jacob Fatu, I think the Usos was going to come out.
I thought they were, too.
Double team him, and yeah. that would have brought Roman out.
I thought so.
And they showed that the Usos were there. They showed, like, fans caught them leaving the building
but now,
and stuff like that.
Now you
stuff.
Know what happens.
And the Hardy Boys even met with them, oh. too. We do have to wrap up the show.
I was going
to
say,
though.
Now you know what happens with the Usos. Now you have all... Because we got to do a show about what we think is going to come.
Yeah.
But definitely
next
what's
week,
to
we'll,
come
we'll
is
touch on that.
You have the next few weeks now where Roman will get the Usos back together, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
But SummerSlam was great.
SummerSlam was great.
Go and watch it.
Each and every week we show different items in the museum. And obviously, here's our item this week on the it's the brand new Topper.
SummerSlam.
The SummerSlam Toppers, which these display boxes is just something that people are really starting to get into. It's really cool. Just make sure you ask permission before, you know, yanking it.
I don't know.
You know
I mean, I've taken some. A lot of people.
Behave.
A lot of people take these things.
Behave.
Every time we go to Walmart, my son's like, Daddy, can we look at the,
anywho,
can we look
sure
at the Cleveland,
guys,
Ohio display?
Make sure you guys scan that QR code to help us get a National Pro Wrestling Day. Congratulations to our three Hall of Famers. SummerSlam hit it out of the park.
Yeah.
And you got anything else to say this week?
Just go back and watch it. It was
really, a really great show. And we'll see you at the matches, folks.